Welcome to Analyst Talk with Jason Alder. It's like coffee with an analyst, but there's no actual coffee. Each episode, we interviewed an expert in the field of law enforcement analysis to share their career-defining stories and to get their insights on the world. Please join us on recognizing and learning from these brilliant minds as we define the law enforcement analysis profession one episode at a time.
Thank you for joining me. I hope many aspects of your life are progressing. My name is Jason Elder, and today our guest has 18 years of law enforcement analysis experience, all focusing on fraud and cybercrime with the TD Financial Group in New Jersey. She's also recently one of Aldea's 40 Under 40 in Philadelphia. She's also the Burlington County Outstanding Woman of the Year for 2016. She also was awarded the 2018 IACA Board of Excellence Award. She is currently IACA's Chair of the International Outreach Committee. Please welcome Yarisa Walsh. Yarisa, how are we doing?
I am great. How are you, Jason?
I am doing well. So lots of awards there. So congratulations. It's well deserved.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, lots of them.
Yeah, so that the Aldea Award for the 40 Under 40, that was their inaugural list. So you are one of the first to be part of this list.
Yes, yes, I was, and very proud and honored to be part of that amazing list, along with so many other individuals that made a great impact to Philadelphia and the surrounding areas.
So were you nominated, or how did you get involved in the list?
So I was nominated. I volunteer into a lot of organizations, you know, a couple of them being IACA, as you mentioned, and the Red Cross and the UN. And so one of the individuals that I volunteered through the Red Cross, she actually lives in Philadelphia. And a couple of years ago, I helped with a gather items for Hurricane Maria to send to Puerto Rico when they were in drastic need of items. And she pretty much remembered me from then. And she said when she saw that, she thought of me. The first thing that came to mind was me. And without letting me know until I get like a notification that I was the winner in a way, she told me that she nominated me and she was very happy that I was selected. So yeah, that's how it all happened. It was rather fast too.
Yeah, well, congratulations again.
Thank you.
Let's start when you were born. So you're born in the Dominican Republic, right? So how do you go from the Dominican Republic to New Jersey?
Oh, wow. That is a book. And I mean like an encyclopedia. I would have to give you a whole detail about that. But, you know, I grew up in the Dominican Republic in a very, very, very poor neighborhood and very crime infested, to say the least. I went to school late, meaning, you know, I didn't go to school at the normal age because it was really violent where we live. My mom was always afraid that if I went out there, I was not going to come back. The theme that we have every season was a type of crime. We have human trafficking, specifically children for organ, you know, the black market. And then we had like gang killing, and there was a lot of stuff happening. So for me, crime actually comes, you know, what I'm doing today comes because of that experience, that bad experience that I have. So eventually we have to move to different countries to, in a way, seek asylum. With my family, I ended up living in several countries, Venezuela. I lived in the Amazon, which I loved. It was fantastic. I got to meet a lot of people. We moved to Honduras. We went to Belize. We lived in Cuba. So I've been all over, to say the least. I lived and visited so many Latin American countries. Then we came back to my country, and to be honest, because I have been mobile so long, it was hard for me to feel like I was at home when I was in my home country. I felt like a part of me was missing something. I remember my aunt had just gotten stationed in Florida. She was kind of working for an NGO that partners with the United Nations. And she asked me if I wanted to come and live with her. And I say yes. So my journey to the United States started in Florida. I went to partially high school there. I went to Miami Jackson High. And then my aunt got moved again to New York. So I moved with her to New York. I lived in the Bronx and Harlem. Then from there, I went to live with my aunt who got transferred now to Pennsylvania. And I lived there. I finished high school there. And then I moved to Jersey to start school, to start college. And that's where I have been since then. Uh-huh. Yeah, that's like the short version of.
No, that's great. I knew that was a very heavy question, right? I was kind of doing it on purpose, but
Will be here all day.
Yes. So, just a couple of follow-up questions to that. So, from the time that you left, you moved around several times. At what age did you leave? And then you said you came back. So, what's the time span there from when you left and when you came back? What ages?
We left my country when I was about 9 years old. And then I came back when I was 12, literally just, you know, went into high school, straight to high school, because at that point in time, I was advanced. I took a lot of summer school to mm-hmm. kind of catch up to those individuals in my grade level, because I missed school so much when I was younger. And I came back and at the age of 12, I was on ninth grade.
Somebody might look at this and say, wow, that seems really unstable in terms of a childhood. Yes. But I mean, all those different experiences obviously led you to who you are today.
Yes. And to be honest, you know, it was very unstable for us as a family. Moving was not as unstable as staying in there, right? Mm. I recall my mom saying to me, two things are going to happen to you if we stay here. You will be dead or you will join a gang. Because those were the only options. You actually had no other options. The police couldn't come to the neighborhood. They didn't have territory there. If the police even attempt, the police would have gotten killed themselves. They were not prepared for that. It was the neighborhood owned by bad people generally. And so that was the reason why primarily my mom made that decision. To me, it was the best because I adopted so many culture, beliefs, and knowledge and skill set from many other people around the world. So to me, I see that as an amazing experience.
So I've heard that Bronx and Harlem can be pretty rough, but I guess when you're rolling in with your background,
I was the bad influence at that point.
you made the whole community worse. Is that what you're saying?
I think I was the bad influence. I was such a, you know, a rebel then. So yeah, no, you know what? There are part of the Bronx that is pretty good. I lived near Marcy Ave, which was next to Jurong Ave and Grand Concourse, were about 3 to 4 blocks away from where the old Yankee stadiums used to be. So I had a lot of great memories from there. And we loved it. It was dangerous, I'm not gonna lie. I mean, we couldn't even take the train really late at night. But compared to where I came from, it was kind of like heaven.
When did you know that you wanted to be in law enforcement?
So, you know how when children are kind of getting older and they're trying to explore what they want to be when they grow up, right? Mm-hmm. I had three professions in mind. I always said that during the morning time, I was going to be a teacher. During the afternoon, I was going to be a doctor. And during the night, I was going to be a police officer.
Oh, wow.
I had a reason for all of that, right? So my goal, and I remember when my mom said to me, why all of those? I said, well, in the morning, I get to teach kids how not to be bad. In the afternoon, I get to fix the people that the bad people hurt. And at night, I get to arrest all those people so that they don't continue hurting people. So I had this rationale behind, you know, like so well planned out. Right. So in my head, I grew up believing and thinking that I wanted to fix all those issues that I saw happening. You know, there were so many great people getting hurt. I lost my childhood best friend, you know, so young. She was kind of kidnapped and she then appears a couple of days later without any organ in a trash can. So I learned all those things at such a young age, something that a young child didn't have to go through. So for me, that was real. I knew that I wanted to do something to fix all those terrible things happening to my people, to the people that I grew up with and people around the world, because even though I'm telling the story in that past tense, right? This is very real and very true in many countries, especially in Latin America and in Africa. So those are things that are true to my heart and the reason why I wanted to get involved. But to be honest, as I got older, I started shifting away from that, right? I knew I wanted to educate people because in my mind, education is a very, very important thing in children's development. So as I started traveling with my aunt and doing a lot of volunteerism all over the world, I started thinking that I was best suited for training people and educating people. And I went to school for that. I went to college for that. And you know, I got my master's, but it was still kind of empty. I still felt that there was something else missing. And I did not know what it was, right? So for me, my career is more circumstantial. It wasn't that I chose to become an analyst. It was that it chose me, right? Which it was weird because normally people say, oh, I chose my career. Well, my career kind of chose me, to be honest. So that's how the twist of it all took place.
How did it choose you?
So circumstantially speaking, I remember when I had just first moved to New Jersey and I have finished my master. Again, I was so young still. I went to the bank to open a bank account in New Jersey because I just moved here. It was kind of like so funny because I come in and I tell the teller I want to make a deposit. And this lady comes in and say, do you speak Spanish? And I pause for a second and say, okay, so she hears my accent. You know, nowadays people are not allowed to do that, right? But then people were very openly saying, oh, I sense an accent. Where are you from? So I remember she asking me, coming out of nowhere, I don't even know where she was, asking me, do you speak Spanish? And I'm like, yes. She said, would you like a job? And I just thought it was so strange. And she was so bubbly too. And I'm like, well, I just moved here. So I was like, sure. I'm like, I probably do need a job because it's going to be hard to get a licensing in education here. I was kind of interviewed on the spot to become the supervisor for a branch, which it was then Commerce Bank and TD Bank. It was instantly, like, by the time I finished opening my account, I interview, and then I went to get my my drug testing done. Literally by the next day, I was already hired as a supervisor, and I didn't even have time to process any of that. So, oh yeah.
That's full service right there, I would say.
That is indeed full service. And in my head, everything was happening so fast. And in my head, I kept thinking, this has got to be a scam. Because, you know, coming from my background, you think everybody's out to get you or everybody's sure. trying to get something from you. So I remember coming home. Then my boyfriend, who's now my husband, I told him, and he's like, that is weird. I'm like, yeah, I know, right? But hey, I'm going to show up tomorrow to work, you know? And so I show up, but it was a legit work, right? So it was true. I was the supervisor. Then I got promoted to acting assistant branch manager. Shortly after, I was kind of managing other branch in the process. Then one day we got robbed, and our robbery was among one of the most violent in the region. Because again, my background, what I've seen in my lifetime, I was able to keep calm while still retaining as much information as I could from, you know, the individuals that held everyone at gunpoint and everything that happened there. From the car description, the height, any tattoo, everything that has to do with that, right? I think from that angle, I don't know if you're aware, but any bank robbery in the United States is a federal crime. So when the FBI came in and they interviewed me, they were like, how are you still calm? How are you able to remember all of this? You know, maybe I'm going to go home later on and just cry my eyes out, right? But right now, I needed to keep cool. I needed to keep my head clear so that I don't lose my life. I remember literally the day, two of the investigators, both of them former law enforcement from the back office, global security investigations, came over. And they asked if I wanted to be part of the global security investigations team. And I'm like, I don't even know what that is. And they're like, well, if you are interested, here's an interview for you. And I'm like, what is wrong with these people? Why are you guys giving interview on the spot? So I did went and interview because I was quite curious, right? And I have a job and I started working as a kind of like the assistant to the investigations team. And to give you a background of our investigations team, all of them have a law enforcement background. So whether they are chief of police, retired chief of police, or FBI agents to Secret Service. So we have a really diverse background of law enforcement. Each of these individuals, we became family. So we were helping each other. It was a great balance that we have because I knew the banking inside and out and they knew the law enforcement. So they kind of took me in under their wing. I loved it. Everything they taught me from going to court to testify, how to kind of address law enforcement, things that I didn't know. And ironically, I'm married to a law enforcement. But it's so weird to be married to one than actually, you know, interacting with one professionally. But that's how my profession chose me. I have been doing that literally since I was 22 years old. and I love it. I don't get tired of it. It's so amazing.
So then you came home and told him, oh, the bank was robbed and I now have a law enforcement job.
No, it wasn't even like that. It was so weird because I remember when we got robbed, they kept us there. My job was supposed to be done by 4 and it was 7 o'clock. And obviously we can, because of privacy, we cannot talk to outsiders until the FBI, you know, interview all of us at once. He showed up. He was scared. And then I guess when he drove and he couldn't see me and all he saw was FBI and law enforcement car park, he really thought something bad happened to me. So you can only imagine how worried he was. So then when I went home, you know, I was so excited. I'm like, so we had a really bad robbery, but hey, I got a job out of the deal. He just looked at me like I was such a weirdo. He was like, Yarisa, you're the only person that come here and say something bad happened, but something really good happened after this. And I'm like, I don't mean it like that. I mean it like, why me? And he's like, okay, I'm just happy that you're good because I was worried.
So was it a hostage situation that you were under?
So how can I put it? It's what we call a morning glory, where it starts really early in the morning. And in a way, yes, it will become almost a hostage if law enforcement made it there, which ironically that day we had just finished servicing one of the law enforcement chief because they come there early in the morning and he had just left. So they were able to leave without being detected, but we were held at gunpoint there until they did what they needed to do.
Oh, wow. So yeah. How long was that where you held at gunpoint?
Oh, my God. It was about good 10 minutes, but it felt like forever. And it felt like forever because a lot of people were getting hurt. You know, me hearing all of that happening and not being able to do or say a thing, it was hurtful. It was brutal. We were all women as well. So me coming from being so very defendant of individuals, not being able to do anything, it was really, really bad. But that's why we go through a lot of STEMC training, and TD Bank is so well known for that. We take care of our individuals to ensure that we know how to handle those type of situations if it ever occurred. And I was very happy to have such an amazing training, because if you're not prepared to do those type of things, anything you do can harm not only your life, but everyone else's life around you.
Wow. Now, did they end up catching them?
No.
Oh, wow.
We were positioned in the middle of a cornfield, so accessible to highways, the turnpike and one of the major highways here in New Jersey, which is 295. So that was an easy escape for them. They found the car because of the direction I gave them. They found the dye packs and everything else, but by then they have switched vehicles. So up to today, we haven't had any actual result of those individuals.
So did the dye packs go off?
So they kind of knew which one it was, and it did. It went off in one of the bags, but I think the one bag had the least amount of money when that did.
So how much money did they get? Do you remember?
Not off the top of my head, but I think it has to be in the very high thousands. So no, don't remember. It was back in 2003, so that was a long time ago.
Yeah, so you think it was an inside job, or do you think they just studied and...
Yeah, I think they study. I don't think the FBI found any internal compromise. I don't think, and we didn't either. So I think they were around, and it's not hard when you are kind of a bank that is sitting, you're like the only super friendly bank sitting in the middle of a cornfield, which was then, you know, to kind of study the process of the banking at that point. And to be fair, I don't know what that was, because that day was my first day back from maternity leave too. So you can only understand why my husband was freaking out. He just thought something happened, and my daughter was left without mom, right?
Oh, sure.
So yeah, that to him was quite worrisome. But I had come back from maternity leave, and then I come back to all this. It was quite chaotic.
Oh, wow.
I remember being frightened, but I don't recall being frightened because of me, but because of my daughter, and obviously because of my colleagues. They were all there. They were scared. They were getting hurt. So I remember being scared for them.
I mean, no one was seriously injured when it was all said and done.
That's correct.
It could have been way worse then. So.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Let's take a break, because we didn't even talk about fraud and cybercrime yet. So cybersecurity. but let's take a quick break. And when we come back, I want to get into all those things. This is Analyst Talk with Jason Elder. We'll be right back. Hi, this is Jason Elder and Mindy Hune from LEA Podcasts. Mindy, how many people voted in last year's IACA election?
Probably around 10 to 11%.
Wow, is that normal?
It's the unfortunate trend.
Wow. What can we do to wreck that trend?
I think we should start by recommending to 10 of our friends, members with the association, and ask them to recommend to 10 of their friends to start voting and getting involved, and we'll go from there.
That sounds like a pyramid scheme.
It is. But it's a good pyramid scheme. It's for a good cause.
All right. So we're going to reach out to 10 friends of ours that are members of the IACA, encourage them to vote, and then ask them to reach out to 10 of their friends to do the same. We're going to recommend 10, and this is going to wreck the trend.
Exactly.
All right. So how do you vote?
You can vote on the IACA website at IACA.net/IACA-election-page.
But I think I already voted in September.
During September, it was just the nomination phase. Now that we're in October, the entire month of October is actually the voting phase. So if you only voted in September, go again to vote, because the vote in September does not transfer over to October.
Well, what if I don't know the candidates?
On that voting page, you can find information on both our candidates. You can find more information on them via the IACA website, the forums, or if you're fans of Analyst Talk with Jason Elder, you can find information on them on leapodcast.com with an S.
Well, what about those that think that their vote doesn't matter?
It does matter. And if we looked at last year's, it was very close that one vote could have made a difference. We're all in this association together. It's important that we have a voice in choosing our next leader. And if you have been a fan of our podcast, a lot of our guests have mentioned that IACA is like a second family. And when you're a part of the family, like, you're important. Your voice needs to be heard. So please vote.
All right. So you heard it. Wreck 10, wreck the trend. So reach out to 10 of your friends, IACA members. You probably haven't talked to them all year anyway. Reach out to them. Encourage them to vote. And let's wreck this trend. Thank you. Welcome back. Before the break, Yarisa was talking to us about the time she was involved in the bank robbery and didn't get a chance to talk about fraud and cyber crimes. So let's get into that now, Yarisa. I guess, do you have a specialty that you focus on, or what are your main tasks in terms of fighting fraud and cybercrimes?
So throughout the year, I have kind of diversify my skills. You know how people say I diversify my portfolio? Well, that's my personal portfolio, right? Mm-hmm. Where my skills have come from being a very, you know, beginner analyst. And again, I remember I didn't have that background. So coming into that whole position as an analyst, it was kind of like, here's your computer. Here's what we're asking. Start analyzing. So my role migrated from there into more, you know, the more I continue doing analysis, I kept becoming more and more fascinated by it. And more things started coming into my plate, more technology focused. I became kind of really good at doing trends related to possible financial and cyber fraud threats. Became pro at gathering the data, reviewing the data, analyzing the data. As a private entity, we are not, unfortunately, just like many law enforcement agencies, are allowed to use open sources because of the risk of cyber risk and, you know, privacy breaches. And we know there's so many of them out there, right? So I became really good at using our internal products to be able to gather the data that we need to help our customers to fight crime and to help them and protect them. I think from my point of view and from what many law enforcement, in cases that I work with law enforcement, I become more of an expert in the financial, organized crime and cybercrime together. And that's the part that I love the most is when something presents a challenge, it's like I love to go and try to find a solution for it. So that's my expertise from that perspective.
So you said you don't use open source. I guess I didn't follow that. What does that mean? I don't even want to try to guess.
So it means that we're not allowed to, like, for instance, if IACA has those wonderful access databases that we can all kind of adopt and customize, we're not allowed to kind of go out there and download that and bring that in and add personal data. We have an in-house technology team that build those for us. We are not allowed to use sources like Facebook. When you go into the API of Facebook and you start trying to locate individuals, we had to be very careful with that. We cannot utilize that. And we are not allowed to use anything that, you know, we had to upload or download data whatsoever to do our analysis. So everything that we have to do, we have to use it from sources and tools that are in-house.
So for the listeners, just kind of give some examples of some of the cases that you've worked on, whether it be fraud or cybercrime.
Sure. Well, this one is my pride and joy because I literally worked on this case for 9 years. It was originally handled by a previous analyst who became an investigator. And him and I had like such an amazing relationship. Our working ethics were very similar. And when he was migrating into that new role, he said, "You want to take over this?" And I'm like, sure, how hard can be, right? Well, it was hard. It took me close to 8 years to kind of get this to go where it went. We started working with the federal agencies. We started working with the postal inspectors, with the Secret Service. The FBI was a collaboration because it was kind of branching out into different states, not just New Jersey, but now is branching out into Philadelphia, is branching out to PA, is branching out to New York. And this was related to identity of individuals that were stolen. It was a group, it was a family affair, as I call it. And they were stealing identity from different individuals. Then they would create checks and they would deposit this check via the ATM with new accounts that they would recruit people, young children, between the age of 17 and 18, to open this account with somebody else's identity. People, their parents were coming to law enforcement. Law enforcement reached out to us and they were like, we have a problem and we want to kind of request your assistance. And one thing led to another. So now it's not just TD Bank, but we have other banking institutions involved. And it was a huge number of people involved working together. Also, in though, there was about 900,000 in losses for just one banking institution.
Wow.
There were other banking institutions that lost $1 million and so on those scheme. 5 individuals were arrested and indicted. I remember I worked so hard on that case. There was 29 10-inch binders created. and wow. containing all the data records. Oh yeah, that I remember when the FBI and the Secret Service came over to gather all those binders, there were boxes after boxes after boxes, and people kind of looking at them coming in and out of the building. They're like, is she getting arrested? Why is she? It was kind of like a weird kind of commotion happening. You can see people looking at me weird too, right? Because we used to work in an area where it was just not global security, but it was other areas, other departments, right? And so seeing people coming in with badge, they were like, whoa, what's happening? But it was quite intriguing as they were taking all those boxes away. They kept saying, you put all of this together. And I remember saying, yeah, that's the most I ever put together. And my I2 chart, I remember it literally could wrap around the courtroom twice. So when it was time to get to the end of it, it was bittersweet because I spent so much time working on that. There was so many aspect of modus operandi that they did. Every time I caught up to what they were doing and I was able to put something in place to stop them, they found another way. And then law enforcement will reach out to me 2 months later saying, we have something else. Let me just show you. And then I start over.
What's an example of that? So you put in some prevention strategies there. What's an example of that?
So from the law enforcement perspective, it would be more communication, but from the internal banking, we put rules in places. You know, like if you go to an ATM to deposit a check at a specific ATM, we were able to kind of like flag that and say, okay, any checks deposited at this X time for this amount, because they were very specific with amounts. You know, it was flagged and then I would come in and review that. And that was manually. That's how dedicated I was to this case, right? So I would come in and review that, and immediately that name will come up and I'm like, oh, I know this is them. And then I'll pull the video and then there they, you know, they are. They were recognized everywhere to a point that I was always hoping to come across one of them at the ATM. you know, that's the mentality you got going on. Like, what do you do if you come across one of them at the ATM? What exactly would you say? So those were the kind of challenges that took place. Is every time, you know, I thought I was ahead of them, they changed their operations completely, or they moved to another state. And then it took another month to get now the agent working in Philadelphia to reach out to the agent working in New Jersey and to the agent working in New York and DC. It was putting us together in one room. That was a challenge in itself. And there were so many meetings that we had to create and a lot of collaborations. It took so much. And obviously the privacy portion of it, law enforcement can only share certain things with us. We can only share things if they give us a subpoena. There was a lot of that too. So that's something that a lot of people don't realize when they're working this type of case, is for collaboration to assist everyone. Everyone needs to be persistent. And that's exactly what happened here.
So how were they getting the identities to then steal the identities?
According to law enforcement, and when I went to the prep before testifying, it had to do with they recruit people that were working at elderly care or a hospital. And so they were stealing the identity of these individuals or the checks, and they would come over and do their stuff in different financial institutions. Yeah.
Would they deposit a little bit of money to start an account and then over withdraw it? Was that how it was done? Or
No, they would just deposit the checks into the account and then they would get a debit card and then would just withdraw that. And then by the time the victim realized that, hey, I'm missing a check, it was kind of late because you're missing money too. You know, if I didn't write that check, you're also missing money. So, yeah.
Oh, I see.
So I do remember when that actually was all over the newspaper in Philadelphia, I got a few people calling, because the thing that private sector and public sector analysts have in common is that when we work so hard on those cases, your name doesn't go anywhere in the news, right? So, but there were a lot of people that knew that I was working very hard on that case. And many of them reached out saying like, oh my God, this is amazing. This is your doing, right? You know, think about this. I'm very involved in the community, and many of those kids that they've recruited and they told them, I'm going to give you, you know, $20 if you go and open an account, they were kids. their parents were upset. Their parents were mortified that there are people out there doing this. And many of those kids were part of a community that I was serving. So many of them were calling the bank. They were crying. They were going to law enforcement. At one point in time, they were calling the investigator, and the investigator was just sending them straight to law enforcement to file a police report. So it was affecting the community in the sense that it was affecting us.
So what was the break in the case?
I would have to go back and read that. Yeah. But it was, I guess, five individuals, two of them cousins. Each of them were charged for identity theft. There was bank fraud. Each of them had like about 5 years. But the one, the mastermind of the game, actually, I think, and he's the one that has not been arrested yet. There's a warrant out for his arrest.
So there was essentially only five of them that were involved in this, and they caused all that kind of havoc through all these different states.
So there were more than that. But as you know, evidence is the key for any prosecution. There were other law enforcement involved, and there were other banking involved, and their product of evidence and facts was not as strong as others. And so because of that, there was not much that the district attorney could do. So there was a lot more than that. Just like I would go as far as saying there was a lot more money, but because the evidence were not strong, the case could only charge few individuals.
It's tough to stop, right? I mean, if you're dealing with somebody that isn't on the ball with your accounts, they're able to steal information from them to create bank accounts. That's a tough thing to stop.
Yeah. Yes. And that's why, you know, one of my things that I do in the community is educating them. A lot of people don't understand how their identity can easily be stolen and used, and how hard it is to put a stop to it. Once your identity is out there, it's out there. You will be haunted by it for many years to come. Again, the reason why all these parents were going to different nonprofit organization crying, allow filing police report, because their children identity, these kids were very young. They were going to be ruined for a long time. You know, as a parent myself, I can only think about how, you know, how much of a pain that is for the parents and for the children. So absolutely, it's really hard to stop from our point of view, you know, us trying to work with law enforcement to save, to protect the identity of the community. But it's also hard to stop those individuals if you don't know who they are committing the crime. That's why it's crucial that everyone knows how to guard the identity, because it's priceless.
You know, it seems like you always hear about these large cases. You talked about the number of binders, or you know, the idea of backing out up a box truck to load all this evidence up. But mm-hmm. It doesn't always have to be this large case that takes years to solve.
No, absolutely not. I mean, I had cases that it was just as simple as I know what the profile is. I go to my internal investigator. My internal investigator gets a subpoena. And normally law enforcement, they love taking, you know, our cases, because it's kind of put together well. And that's a sense of pride that I have from that perspective, because often they come to us and they say, hey, we're seeing a pattern. We're going to send you a subpoena. Can you work with us? And of course, we're trying to save the community a headache and our clients specifically, right? But I have cases that takes me about a month to put all together and give it to law enforcement, but it takes a longer time to prosecute for whatever reason or other, you know, obviously fact checking. Law enforcement and the district attorney's office have to fact check all these things that we're giving them, make sure that it goes with the possible charges that they're trying to bring on board. And then there's the prepping of the team and myself, you know, depends. I remember I had a case where it was very gang related, and I had to go to a police department to testify on a video while they blur my face. And we are very notorious, unnotorious, to put my name in bold on an I-2 chart. So they came back and they're like, you need to wipe that out. Your name cannot be there. So like I said, it can take a month, but it depends of the level of involvement from law enforcement, whether it's local, whether it's federal, whether it's your bank only, whether it's many banks, the privacy perspective. There's a lot of aspect that happens behind the scene between a collaboration between law enforcement and an agency. Yeah.
So what are some examples of some cyber crimes that you've worked on?
Identity theft, and that's because those are the most easy in a way to prosecute from a law enforcement perspective, especially if you have a phone call attached to that or a device attached to that is the easiest way. Anything else that is more of a data breach or anything from that, we kind of stay behind because those are part of our security management team, and that completely falls into a different categories. But most of them are ID theft related.
And then what advice would you have for analysts that may find themselves involved in one of these cases, whether it's a fraud case or a cyber crime case?
So I'm going to give this advice because I work very closely with a lot of the analysts in New York. They are very quick at reaching out and set up a meeting and collaborate, of course, with the permission of their investigator or detective handling the case. So if you find yourself handling any white-collar crime, financial crime, possibly cyber crime, and you know there is a banking institution currently working or kind of handling, ask the permission of your detective or your investigator and, you know, reach out to that institution to see if they have an analyst working and set up a meeting and brainstorm together. Because working individually, that delays the process, trust me. Collaboration, and this is something that I would always tell people, collaboration goes a long way. And I feel like often there is this bias where people say, well, private sector analyst doesn't do the same as law enforcement analyst. And for the most part, that is correct. But you'd be surprised of the similarities of the things that we do.
Now, you mentioned the blank chart. They normally tell you don't cross the lines.
Yeah.
But I can't imagine a 10-foot blank chart that you didn't cross a line or two.
And I told them to. And it was funny that you mentioned that because as I'm telling you this, I'm like, oh boy, this is going to come back to me. Not right. I told them. And you know, at the end of the day, it comes to who is handling this case. I had a district attorney office that the ADA called my I2 charge your big spreadsheet. And I was like, what? It is not a spreadsheet, which it was kind of odd, but okay, I let it go. But I told them, we need to kind of put them in, let's do an I2 just for the individual rather than entire crew, because that timeline is going to be very confusing. And they wanted their very long I2 charts. I was like, you know what? If that's what you want, I'm going to give it to you. But in my head, I kind of split it into individual as well. And then I remember showing up in Philly with like 10 tubes, literally, with I2s individually labeled in there. All these tubes I was carrying into like a big bag just to show them. So you wanted a long, long one, but I also had them individually just in case you need them.
Sure. How did they even hang that up in the trial?
They got creative. There was like a part where I'm trying to explain, like she taped it and then she kept rolling and then unpinning it and then rolling and rolling again. And I'm like, that is actually very time consuming.
Was it so she kind of did it like a scroll where there would be rolls on each side?
That would be like rolls on each side. She kept going and unrolling. Like she actually she did an amazing job though, memorizing that whole thing. She said that she hung that in her tiny little room and she just like went through it. It was like, okay. But no, they wanted it. I gave it to them. But I was prepared just in case they were like, yeah, this is too long. But yeah, I crossed the line. And this time it worked. Not sure that it's going to work in the future.
So in general, for somebody that just is either layperson or somebody that's not familiar with it, in terms of fraud and cyber crimes, how prevalent are they?
Very. Yeah, they are very prevalent. And that's the good part and the bad part. If you are an analyst that you're working on this area, there's a lot of amazing things you can do and you can get creative. And at the same time, you can actually help people. But if you don't understand the concept, it can also be very dangerous for you and whoever else that is involved in it. So I would suggest anybody that wants to deep dive into this, that they get educated and then find someone to mentor them so that they can understand when they go into it. And you know what? One can say the same thing for just any other crime out there, but this one requires a complete different think outside the box type of idea and hat.
So years ago, fraud and other financial related crimes were considered white collar crimes. Mm-hmm. And even though you might have a high dollar amount, the punishment, even when convicted, wasn't as high as, say, like a robbery. How is the punishment and the crime for some of these card fraud or these cyber crimes?
So it is very, it exists, but it's different. Fraud and white-collar crime have evolved so much that an aspect of a white-collar crime can have other type of crime within itself. And so back in the day, you know, maybe law enforcement would say something like, oh yeah, unless you reach the 100,000 threshold, we cannot take it because it's really, it's not even going to be worth it. But then now with so many privacy laws in place, there's that portion of it where if privacy of a person has been breached because of that white collar crime, then now is another offense. So it depends. I have heard people saying, you know, if it is under 100,000, we're not taking it. But then the minute you add the identity theft and the number of complaints to that district of ID theft, immediately the district attorney's office feel obligated to investigate those and to take those cases. So at that point in time, the threshold is completely overwritten by that. That's something that one of the reason why I say this deal can be a little complex, because not only now you're trying to protect your client, but now are you working the right case to give to law enforcement so that they may possibly be able to bring someone to justice because of what they have done to the public? It can become a little bit complex, to be honest. Yes.
All right. Well, let's take another break. When we come back, I want to talk about your work with the IACA and the International Outreach Committee. You're listening to Analyst Talk with Jason Elder. We'll be right back.
Hi, this is Mary Bertuccelli. Would you like to solve a cold case? If your answer is yes, then enter a cold case from your agency into VICAP, the FBI's Violent Criminal Apprehension Program. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Rhea Gerstenkorn, and my advice to you is to not be that analyst that people refer to what not to do. You don't want to be that person. So make sure that your products are of quality. Make sure that you're doing what you need to do. Ask questions if you're not sure, but don't be the reference point of what not to do.
Welcome back. Before the break, Yarisa was talking about her experience helping fight and prevent fraud and cybercrime. I wanted to take the chance for this last segment of the show, Yarisa, and talk about your work with the IACA and the International Outreach Committee. So for somebody that may not be familiar with this committee, could you just briefly give an overview of what the mission of this committee is and the purpose and so on?
Absolutely. So our mission is to take what IACA has done in the U.S. when it comes to training and mentoring analysts in U.S. And also in Canada, and just take it further into different continents, right? So our committee is currently based on different type of continents. We have the African, we have the Asian, we have the Canadian, because even though they're North American, their policies are completely different. We have the European and we have the Latin American committee. And also under my structure, we have the translation committee who is led by Anne Lohr. And she is so instrumental to everything that we're doing within the IACA. But our goal is to give the audience, the international audience, a sense of belonging into the family of analysts. Analysts is such a foreign concept all over the world outside the United States, but it's such an instrumental one when it comes in place to do a better policing from that structure. So we want to bring that all over the world and not just keep it to ourselves here in America.
So why do you think analysis is a foreign concept in so many places?
So going to speak on behalf of Latin America. For normally, when you think about analysis, it's kind of foreign because the first thing people bring to their head is, oh, God, that sounds like I now need to use technology. And we're not trained to do that. As an investigator, now I'm going to have to know how to investigate, to research, and then I'm going to have to use technology to go into a very, very, very deep dive into an investigation. So they're thinking now they have to become technology expert to kind of get to that. And they are not understanding that analysis can be a crucial part of their work. And many of them are already doing them and they don't even know that. So that's how they think. And I know because I have asked them, and many times is the fact that they don't have resources and that they haven't been trained in a long time, and they have this old process in place that they keep using and they don't think outside their boxes. So that's why it seems to be a little bit kind of like a foreign concept for them.
So what are the major challenges of taking the IACA model and bringing it into local foreign countries?
There is many challenges. For one, the policies are completely different. So what we refer to things, you know, in the United States, the amendments and how we do a specific things doesn't apply in those countries. So even creating something as simple as a training is not the same. So we can talk about operational analysis in Latin America. That's kind of like, what? That's just being an assistant. What are you talking about? So there's a lot of things that we have to kind of adjust and modify when we are bringing it to other continents, just because it may not be interpreted the same way. Even talking about the certification, I remember Carola Czeskonski, who was just recently on your show. For her, we had to work with the certification committee so we can modify some of those things because it was not applicable in her country. You know, she shouldn't know a lot of those laws and judicial topics in her country is completely different. So even working with something as simple as that, it becomes a challenge for us across the globe.
If you have all these challenges where, you know, the mindset might be, well, that's an American product, that's not going to work here. So how do you get the buy-in to show them what you're trying to give them?
Well, I'm going to give you two great ways. First one is your relationship with leaders. You have to have a strong relationship. First thing, the individuals that are part of my committees are very well connected with other offices, with other agencies, and they are get done type of individuals. They reach out, they have those connections that are needed, and these individuals are willing to listen and see our commitment to modify things, to make it better. After all, they know that we need each other. They need us to train their team to do better the way that many, you know, analysts are helping law enforcement here in the United States. But for that to take place, they know we need them to tell us what worked with them and for them and how to make it, to advertise it and make it a bit more focused on them rather than focused on every other continent. It's not a one size fit all here. It's that let's fix what it is that you need in your community, and we're going to move on from there and try to help others the same way that we just helped you. So for us, is the team that I have. They're so committed. All of them are so well committed, and they're very close to their network. So it's their commitment to IACA and to the community of analysts that allows this to happen and the buy-ins to take place.
You've recently taken over as chair within the last year. What's your goal moving forward?
So this year, even with COVID, we're probably going to end up doing over 20 webinars in Spanish that has never been done before. We're working on our 13 right now. So by the end of this year, we should have over 20. And each year, it seems like we have more and more audiences from all over the world. So my goal is to take what model the Latin America subcommittee have built in and bring it across all over continents. Subsequently, we also want to have a more collaborative kind of community. We don't want just the committee to do the, you know, to do the training or to do the mentoring. We want everyone to teach each other because we all have skills that can be transferable to other teams and other people in other countries. So we want to kind of create like that kind of community where you log in and instead of sending something through the forum, you say, hey, I need help with this, you know, does anybody know this? And somebody's going to point out and say, yep, Yarisa is available for you, you know. That's going to take a long, long time. It's very technology involved. I know Manny San Pedro is probably sitting over there and saying, oh my God, no. But the goal here, and I still in Rachel Carson's idea, the goal is to be able to teach each one how we can all do collaboration without having to break the rules of privacy.
You know, one of the things I think the IACA struggles with is getting folks to the conference. We missed this conference this year, obviously, because of COVID. What would you like to see different in the future with the conference?
Yeah, so I think this is amazing that you're asking me, because a lot of people, I am very transparent and I'm very open door to suggestion from all members. I mean, they always reach out to me and they very transparently tell me what bothers them and what doesn't. And I do a great job just escalating that to the highest levels possible. And one of the headaches that I always see is the fact that we want to be international, but yet we are not too inclusive to international as far as conferences. And perhaps we now can integrate a video for those analysts that are not able to make it to the country. There's visas. Some of them have to get 6 months in advance to get here. There's a lot of things that takes place behind the scene. The IACA does not know for this individual to get to the United States. So they have asked, you know, maybe we can have in each of those sessions, we can have like a video taking place. And through that video, there will be a translator. Obviously, it may be costly, but it's doable. And if we charge the right amount of money, many people may be able to. Another thing that other members have asked is, you know, is there a way that IACA kind of have like a point system, like a CPE or CEU, which is kind of credit, experience learning credits, that when you take these courses, it can apply and they subsequently can apply that to other certifications that they have, because otherwise they're just spending money to come to a conference and getting this training, but they're really not applying it to anything else that they have. So those are things that I have brought up to Kyle that perhaps we need to look into this, because it may attract more people. As you know, and I don't know how familiar you are with those type of credits, but many people that have numerous certification and they need to meet the certifications criteria annually or biannually, they need these courses. And if they pay to come to an IACA conference, they might as well get some of those CPUs or CPEs credit to bring to their other certification, or even, you know, the CLIA certification in the near future. So those are kind of like the things that I would like to see in the future, based on some of the feedbacks that I have received from members.
One thought that I had, and this doesn't necessarily pertain to the conference, but Rachel Carson is VP of membership now. So she's actually an international member to the board.
Yes.
To ensure that IACA is international at all times, I'd actually like to see the IOC chair be a board member. It would be an elected position, but it would ensure that the association remains international at all times.
Yeah, because I feel that we're not, even though we are there, we're not being too inclusive. I often find myself having to reach out to different people because I see a great email going out, but it wasn't translated. You know, here we have a translation subcommittee that they translate from French, German to French, German, and Spanish, Portuguese, and they're not being utilized. And we want to kind of reach out as many people in their language as we can. And this is so important to me. I often find myself just like going through all those email and sending it out to Anne Laure's team and asking her, translate, so I can send it, right? Because there's so many emails that people send out, and even the board and committees, that many of our international members can really, really, really take advantage of that. A good example was the other day, somebody reached out to me, and it was because he was from Italy and he saw our Facebook posting. He reached out and he was like, "You guys are amazing. The work you're doing is great. I would love to have you here." You know, like, he was a fan, and I love seeing those emails. And of course I went and replied, and I'm like, "Let's chat." That makes me very happy because I feel like I'm really helping the community, and translation is the key to that.
So if somebody is producing something for either the IACA forum or a report and they want to get something translated, how would they go about doing it?
So right now, and that's the great part, if they want something translated, you have two options. You can actually go into the forums, and within IACA, there's like a little flag on the very bottom to the right. You can literally choose your country's flag or the language flag in this case, and just translate to that language in there, which is the perfect.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you can. It's perfect. Or you can just simply reach out to us. And what I would do is I would reach out to Anlor Del Cerro's committee, and she will have the team translate, and then I will resend it so people can actually see the translation. I've done that for several of our Spanish speaking team that are looking for assistant, and I know that, and they don't know how to do the translation. So it works out before. I mean, we even helped someone here in the United States to kind of track a chief of police in the United States here to track his sister in Austria, just because of the collaboration that we have. So it's fascinating. Every time I hear this story, it makes my heart super big with joy. It does.
Because even with the podcast, we create a version on YouTube. And one of the reasons we do that is YouTube will create the subtitles, the closed captioning for us. And then folks can go in there and they can change that closed captioning, subtitles, to a whole host of languages.
Yep. That's how at the IACA website, Google does the same thing. So if you change that little flag to your country language, it will do the translation for you.
Okay. I just want to finish up the interview with some of your personal interests. And you've started this interview talking about all the various places that you lived growing up as a child, and traveling has continued to be part of who you are.
Yes.
Traveling to 43 different countries and four continents. What maybe are some of your favorites or ones that you want to talk about that are really under the radar locations that you really would highly recommend to folks?
Oh, wow. That is so not fair. Yeah. Every country I go, I love. I fall in love with something about them because they're so unique. I would say if you haven't traveled at all, start small. You don't have to make a huge deal. And it's always on budget. I said Czech Republic. When I first traveled there, I fell in love with the historic of it. And also even the people there, generally speaking, everything in Czech Republic was fascinating and I loved it. But then I went to Austria, which is next door, and you can just pretty much take the train. In my case, I rented a car and went across country. You know, Austria was equally nice. There's so much beauty. And I have my friend Sam Steiner to actually thank for that, because he actually was such an amazing host when I was there. It was me and several other IACA people that we went there back in 2014. But I had such a great time. So if you are interested in learning history past the age of the United States, you definitely need to go to Europe, because you're still going to understand a lot of the things that came to the United States. And you're like, oh, so that's why. So take a trip there, take a trip to Austria, and definitely visit the Opera House. You must. They have free opera there, you know, so take advantage of that. It's rare, but you definitely get to enjoy a lot of it.
Good. I like that answer. I thought you were not going to give me a real answer there. I was worried there. I know that was, again, a very heavy question that I gave you. But one destination that's on my bucket list is Cuba.
And I don't
know if it's because it's forbidden, but everybody tells me it's stuck in time in a way with some of that. And I want to see that. I want to experience that whole thing.
It is. And you know what my husband does too? This whole American situation, you cannot travel there because X and Y, right? But I got to live there. And you know, when you're a child and you see all those old cars, you're like, what? These cars are so old. And, you know, you complain, but But now you look back and you're like, oh my God, those cars are like actually amazing. They're still running and they look just as pristine as they look back when, you know, when they were first built. That's what you're going to see in Cuba. You're going to see all those Cadillac, all those old, old, beautiful Cadillacs that very high-end people used to drive here in the United States like many years ago. And people are driving them with pride. And the people in Cuba are, oh my God, they're so nice. They, even if they don't know you, they'll give you a hug and they say hello to you. One of the reasons that I love living in Cuba. And then obviously you have to love the food. The food is amazing. And the buildings, I think in consideration that Cuba was one of the countries that was colonized way before the United States was thought to become United States. You know, we're talking about the 1500th. And so all those buildings are sitting in there still intact and looking just as if you actually travel back in history. So you'll love it once you go there. You may have to go to Canada first and then travel to Cuba.
I'll make it there someday.
But... Oh, you should. Everyone should.
All right. Well, our last segment is Words of the World. And this is where I give the guest the last word and you can talk about whatever topic that you want to. But Yarisa, what are your words to the world?
For me, it's more an advice to all analysts out there, which is collaborate. I know sometimes there could be a lot of bias in the field, but I think you need to get to know other analysts from other countries and from other fields, whether private sector or public, and have that connection and that networking. And that way, by you doing that, you can expand your knowledge and your skill set. You'd be so surprised how much you gain from doing that.
Well, I leave every guest with, you've given me just enough to talk bad about you later, but I do appreciate your time and being on the show. Thank you so much, and you be safe.
You too. Thank you, Jason.
Thank you for joining us today on Analyst Talk with Jason Alder. We hope you not only enjoyed the show, but also learned something new. For more information on our guests and information relating to today's topic, please visit our website at leapodcast.com. Special thanks to The Rough and Tumble for our theme song. For more of their music, you can visit their website at theroughandtumble.com. Also thanks to Kyle McMullen for our show logo. For more of his design, please visit his website at moderntype.com. The show is hosted, recorded, and edited by Jason Elder and written by me, Mindy. You can contact us both via the LEA podcast website. Please join us again next time as we interview another expert in this great field.